Good morning again, dear Manna family. We're together for day 4 of Morning Manna Repent Edition. Our theme for the next 2 weeks, Return and Revive, will be much lighter, I promise. As I've prayed for y'all during these 3 weeks of prayer and fasting, I've asked the Lord to reveal His Father's heart of love for you. And sometimes, Abba has to sit us down and tell us the truth. So in review, R, recognize that I am a sinner. E, exchange my will for His will. P, pray and confess receiving forgiveness. And today's letter, E, earnestly seek to provide restitution and reconciliation in a humble spirit. We're going to begin with 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11. For godly grief, the Greek word there is lupe, and it literally means sorrow or heaviness. For godly sorrow produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. For see what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. Repentance is absolutely a decision. It sometimes has to be made without accompanying feelings of remorse or guilt or sorrow or sadness, but it eventually results in some sense of grief. Let's look at Romans chapter 2, just really quickly, 2 verse 4. Or do you presume on the riches of His kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? The Apostle Paul is appealing to actions as well as to emotions in this passage. He's saying, do you not recognize that God loves you so much that He has been richly kind, enduring, tolerant, and patient with you, as that should lead you to repentance and sorrow? We're going to look at the contrast laid out in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11 today. That's the verse that we started out with just a moment ago. As a guide for ourselves, but also as a tool to measure those with whom we are in relationship. Now that may seem very harsh to some of you. You could say, but we're not supposed to judge each other, and you would be correct if you mean judge in the condemning vengeance sense. But the scripture also says, judge righteous judgment, and you will know them by their fruits. These two verses in 2 Corinthians are the template by which we judge ourselves and our repentance and others and their repentance when their lives intersect with ours in some meaningful way. Don't let me sidetrack us with this slight rabbit trail, sorry, but I felt compelled to bring this up. This is for some spouse, parent, or friend who keeps bumping into an I'm sorry with no change in behavior. It is the template to measure whether what we are hearing and seeing is godly sorrow or worldly sorrow. But now, back to our point. For godly grief, godly sorrow, produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. The contrast is in what godly and worldly sorrow looks like. So godly sorrow leads to salvation in the verse we were just looking at. That Greek word is soteria, and it literally means safety, both physically and morally, without regret. Ametameletos is the Greek word there, which is translated irrevocable. But if we can go back and look at that again, it means godly sorrow leads to salvation that is irrevocable, whereas worldly sorrow produces death. So the worldly word, the word translated worldly, is the Greek word cosmos. Again, you're probably familiar with this word. It means the physical world or the adornings of the world. In other words, it has to do with outward appearance. Worldly sorrow, same word, lupe, which means mourning, leads to, that Greek word is katergazomai, leads to means it accomplishes what it set out to do, or it performs it, or in a sense, it fashions it. So worldly sorrow is designed to fashion. Thanatos is the Greek word, and it literally means death. Worldly sorrow, in which we have all unfortunately participated, is the sorrow we feel because we've been exposed. Look at the deeper meanings of those Greek words. They all have to do with our image, how we're viewed, how we're perceived. Worldly sorrow results in being sad because we are caught and the consequences we have to face because of that, and maybe the lack of respect. Worldly sorrow is always focused on me. It does not consider what my attitudes and actions may have done to others, much less what they've done to God. So let's look at the next verse, godly sorrow. Verse 11, for see what earnestness, the Greek word there is spoude, it means speedy eagerness to take care of business. What earnestness, very important word, what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you, but also what eagerness to clear yourselves. That Greek word is apologia, and it means to plea or apologize. What indignation, what fear, what longing, what zeal, what punishment. The Greek word ekdikesis means retribution or punishment. Godly sorrow basically says, this is what I did. What can I do to make it right? I am willing to accept the consequences. I want justice done, even if it means I have to suffer loss to make things right. Godly sorrow says to God, you are God and I am not. Do what you will with your servant. And it says to others, I acknowledge what I've done to you and I will earnestly. That's the attitude that we're looking for in ourselves and in others when the word repent is used. I earnestly seek to make restitution and to come to reconciliation if that's possible. Lord Jesus, work into us earnest hearts to serve you and to live humbly with each other. Love you guys. Thank you for hanging in there with me in this very serious but important topic. And I will see you tomorrow. Big hugs.